Amazing. Let's give our name back some. And the Soul Center House Band. Come on up. And Jesse. And Brian. And Jeff. What a joy. I just want to start out by just telling you how deeply grateful I am for Patricia and Jessica.
Yes.
Yeah. 3 years ago, it was at another center, and it was just a suite, but I could tell how in consciousness this community has grown. And I'm just like, I'm in a state of celebration.
Yeah. Woo!
Thank you, and thank you for having me.
Yay!
It is really, truly an honor to be in this community and to witness a vision coming into form. You know, that is truly the great law, and how it works is that everything starts as an idea. I was just talking with Michelle this morning, and she was telling me about how she read something in Napoleon Hill, and Thomas Edison. It was a story about Thomas Edison, and the quote is, when you have the idea, you are halfway there.
Yes.
Yes.
And so like, that's a huge law, and to lean into and to remember. So many in the world today, they're just, you know, in a rote of living. And the idea is it doesn't even cross their mind, that the potentiality and the possibilities inherent in the idea. So thank you, Soul Center. And so I am also very grateful to be here with you today to, together as a community, turning our attention and our awareness and the conversation and our consciousness to what really is, to a reality, to a power, to a presence, this living, infinite intelligence that is truly the only cause, not two causes. There's not a cause of all that is, of the infinite power and the infinite presence, and then another cause over here that is sort of in contradistinction to it. There's only one cause, one source, one power, one presence. And when they say that it is omnipotent, that means it's the only cause, power, and presence. When they say that it is omniscience, that it is the only intelligence. There's not this one thing called God that is a big intelligence, and then there's other intelligences that are contradictory to it. There's only one intelligence, one infinite presence. So a presence, and what we're talking about is a principle of oneness, but it's also a presence. I remember, you know, I grew up in Texas, Southern Baptist. I'm a recovering Southern Baptist. And, you know, the idea of God given to me was, you know, an anthropomorphic man in the sky. And he had an anger management problem. And thank God for Jesus, the great mediator, you know, because I knew like he would vouch for me. He loved me, at least. And, you know, it was okay. I mean, I loved God as a little girl. I was just born this way. I was really, truly born this way. And the belief system that I was born into, you know, it kind of worked. It backfired by the time I was 10, 12, 14 years old. You know, I just threw the towel in because, you know, things had kind of gone south for me. It wasn't an easy childhood, and, you know, just the belief system had beat me down, and I didn't think I was going to get to go to heaven and all that. And I, you know, by the time I was 24, you know, I studied other things, you know, as a young girl looking at, you know, just other philosophies of life, and the Rosicrucian and the shamanic journey, and you know, paganism and all this, and, you know, considering the idea that, you know, God is a woman. You know, that was a nice idea for a while, but still, she was out there, and I didn't really know her very well. And then in my 20s, I found 12-step recovery, and I was allowed to, I mean, literally, I was told that I was allowed to reform my concept of God, and the concept that I could inherit was a friendly God.
Yes.
And it was friendly and loving and for me. And it still had its own will, though. That was the little catch there. It still had its own will for my life. And that didn't feel good, because after a while, there were things that I didn't get, I wasn't expressing, I wasn't experiencing, you know, love and intimacy, or I wasn't experiencing an abundant flow, or I wasn't experiencing the true calling of my heart, the vocation of my heart, and then I would turn to the belief system of, you know, well, it must be God's will. Mm. And its will, I guess, you know, is better than my will, and I should surrender to its will, it over there, a God outside of myself, and that was frightening. And then when I found New Thought,
yes,
I realized, I was taught, I came into a greater awareness that was beyond a concept of this infinite power and presence. I came into an awareness that there is a direct contact that is available to each of us, that is not given to us by some kind of outside authority of, you know, what God is, but a turning to an inherent knowing in your bone of your bone that there is a power and a presence that beats your heart, that breathes you, that is unfolding its life, that created you out of itself because it wants to experience its own diversity in the myriad ways that it creates, and so it extended itself and put your face on it. Just like it created the dandelion or the rose, it created that in its own diversity, in its own creative genius, and the job of the rose, for example, is to bloom and release its beauty, which is its gift, its fragrance, which is its gift. And so there's nothing in the rose that turns to itself and says, gosh, I was born in this soil that's kind of depleted, and I'm not getting enough sunlight, or I'm not getting enough water, and maybe it's God's will that I'm not supposed to bloom. The rose doesn't do that. It doesn't look at its circumstances and think that this is the will of the divinity inherited me. No. Because God only knows its own nature. God doesn't perceive lack. We perceive lack because we have a dualistic experience here in this time-space third dimension. And so we have a perception of blockage or lack or limitation, but that doesn't make it real. Perception is what the mind tells the brain to do with the sensory data that's hitting, the electromagnetic sensory data that's hitting the neurons in your brain. The brain will edit, delete, and distort all of this electromagnetic data to fit into the paradigm that you already are walking in. And then that paradigm simply just cycles and repeats itself based on your perception. Okay? So our role here in this body temple, in this dimension, on this beautiful capsule called planet Earth, is to begin to root down to what is real so that we can rise up above our perception, above our circumstances, above the concrete and depleted soil or lack of sunshine or lack of water. These circumstances of our life, they're just called phenomena. That's what they are. Phenomena. They don't have a reality. You are a nomina. You are an infinite power and a presence that has never been born and will never die. The rose doesn't look to its value, doesn't look to its circumstance for its value. It already knows its value, and it will express its gift to the greatest ability that it can based upon its circumstances. And so that's what we are here to do. And we root down by knowing what we are, whose we are, and where we actually have our being. You are an infinite light. You are a radiant spirit that is eternal in its nature. You have never ever been born, and you will never ever die. You are an eternal living intelligence that has no limits and infinite potentiality that only can express and create more of itself. That is the nature of God. Now, that doesn't mean that you don't have an experience of any kind of trouble or tribulation, but it's just like a dream. If you have children, you know this, or even dogs, you can see animals dream when they're moving their little paws in their sleep. You can tell when the child has a dream, and it's a nightmare, and it's a real experience for them. But as the parent or grandparent, you know they're just dreaming. And they wake up, and they're startled, and they're, you know, you've had these kinds of experiences. Your heart's beating, you're sweating, it was real, it felt real. But then you woke up, and you realized, I was dreaming. That's exactly what it is. And so we are here to become the lucid dreamers of this planet. And that's why these centers are popping up all over. Because people like you are being called. You have a higher calling. Yes. And that is the talk title. Root down to rise up. You are the answer to the call. Your answer to the call.
Yes.
Your answer to this call, it is a calling from your highest self, your oversoul, the great divine presence that created itself and called itself you so that it could experience itself, more of itself, through the avenue called you. And you're here to release and express and experience these divine gifts. Maybe it's creativity. Maybe it's through your vocation. Maybe it's through how you show up in your relationships. Maybe it's through the gifts you have as an artist or a writer. Or maybe it's through the gifts you have through whatever your career or your vocation is. It doesn't matter. There's probably way more than one gift.
Yes.
But I'm telling you that the will of God is the same as the nature of God. So nowhere is the will of God for it not to fully express itself. Nowhere is the will of God for you to ever experience or learn something or have a hardship through suffering. This is important to remember, especially if you grew up in a religious ideology that taught you that. You know, these belief systems, they are like the predominant tape that will run in the background. And if you're not paying attention, what is either, whether you are conscious or unconscious, these predominant subconscious tapes will tend to outpicture as your life. Because again, it's the paradigm you're living in. Your paradigm that is created by your thought. And so we choose our thoughts. We can't control our thoughts. You cannot control that monkey mind. But you can take dominion over it through your awareness. And when you can catch the thoughts that do not serve you, these old ones of not being enough, or not being lovable, or not being wanted, or it's just not your time, or it's bad hair day, or it's just not, you know, it must be the stock market, or it must be the, or being, thinking that you're subject to laws of man whose breath is in his nostrils. These are not the law, the one law, the only power, the only cause. When we are thinking that we are subject to the mind, this monkey mind, and we become aware of ourselves, aware of our thoughts, what we begin to do is establish the new neural net in our brain. This is what I teach through affirmative prayer technology. And I am passionate. I mean, my main community is the Agape International Spiritual Center. It's where I'm a minister. And my vision there, and my vision here, and my vision anywhere I go, is that whoever walks through the doors has access to this thing that we call affirmative prayer technology, because it is a very powerful technology of six steps, using the left and right brain, linking the right brain, which is connected to the heart, which is your subconscious, your unconscious, which is processing 40 billion bits of information per second, linking it to the left brain, which is what's dealing with language, it's what's taking measurements, and marrying them with the sound carrier wave and your heart field. You have an electromagnetic field around you because of your heart that is at least 30, I think they're saying 30, I know they're saying like a mile out. First I heard 30 feet. I don't know who's doing these measurements. The Heart Math Institute actually is doing these measurements. The HeartMathInstitute.org, it's a wonderful. At least 30 feet out, there's an electromagnetic field of your heart. And so we're all sitting in each other's heart right now. Isn't that wonderful?
Amazing.
And with the sound carrier wave, which is, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and that's the Logos. In Greek, that word is the Logos, which if you look up what Logos means, it means being of sound. And they can show through, they show now that formation occurs through sound. The planets rotating make a sound. Everything has a frequency. So sound is the great formation of this living presence of the unseen into seen. And you have your heart carrier wave. And so you are built to use this affirmative prayer technology. That is actually the purpose, I believe, of our each individual bio-body suit. The heart, the voice, the left and right brain, your ability to take the measurement, but yet to allow something to be prayed through you. And so we root down to rise up. And the rooting down is knowing that you are this power and this presence that created itself and called itself you, that you are one with it, you are it, that it is here to express these divine qualities of God, and that there is nothing that blocks, hinders, or delays that, because nothing can stand in the way of the only thing that is, the only cause. That's why you're here. And when that happens, when you can root down and know that, especially using affirmative prayer and practices, I can see that it's why we're here. It says, through the practice and application. So that's what our job is to practice and apply. Then we rise up out of the circumstances of our life and we become the answer that the world is seeking, or the answer that you as an individual may be seeking. It's not a getting. It's not a having. The rose doesn't get the fragrance. The rose doesn't get the beauty. The rose releases the fragrance, releases the beauty. And that is the great flow. That is the great will. That is the great power in the presence. And that is what you are. Yeah. That is what I know. Yeah. Affirmative prayer, shall we?
Yes.
I'll be lasered about it. How grateful I am to take this holy breath, knowing that there really is only one living life, one divine power, one presence, to know it is a non-dual good. It does not have an opposite. It only knows its own name and nature, and it is our life. We, each of us, live and move and have our being in and through and has this infinite love, infinite beauty, infinite abundance, infinite power. And so it is from this oneness that I know something wonderful is happening for each of us, that there is a wholeness that is taking place in every cell, organ, action, function of our body temples, that there is an infinite supply and abundance that is taking place in our consciousness, knowing that our awareness of this divinity as our abundant consciousness is our abundant supply. And so I am knowing truly that this creative genius that is God is fully expressing, going before us this day, making all the crooked ways straight, that everything flows in such a beautiful, creative, living life as our life. We are here to express it.
Yes.
And I'm so thankful that my word is a law unto itself, that I have stood here with the authority of one who knows who and who she is.
Yes.
And I know it is done.
Yes.
And I release it.
Yes.
I let it be.
Yes.
And so it is.
So it is.
All right.